All too often, people are failing in life. They're failing because they misinterpret him. They're failing because someone misrepresented him. They're failing because they've never really heard him for themselves. Not realizing that words that come from humanity are words of confirmation rather than direction. When I preach, I'm not looking to direct someone's life, but to confirm what the Spirit of the Lord has already put in them. Because I would never want someone totally dependent on their walk with Christ through me. And it's like the potter's hand, the Holy Spirit works on the inside while we work on the outside. Is when I would preach, and especially the Sunday morning, people would come to me and say, man, I was reading that scripture this week. God was speaking to me about those very things. This week was I just meditating on those things. And I realized that I was working on the outside while he was working on the inside, and that we were in harmony together. That I wasn't looking for some abstract truth that was beyond where he was at with the people. So when we're working with people, we're not there to exalt ourselves, but just to be working with the Holy Spirit. Many times when I start talking to people and I can see that what I'm giving them is total revelation, then sometimes you've got to come back and work them back into a relationship with the Holy Spirit. Because what will happen is they will become codependent on you. And when they become codependent on you, then they're like a tree planted in the desert. They only get watered when you come to water them. And they've never learned to put down their roots into the hidden source of the river that runs so close to their souls, which is the Holy Spirit. And therefore growing at all times. And so I really want to just this morning clear up prophetically some of the hindrances and get people back tuned into the right station. Sometimes there's so much static coming into their minds from a three-dimensional relationship that they are not fellowshipping in the Spirit. And it's like a radio that's trying to bring in three different signals at once. In the Bible, there's the wisdom of man, there's the wisdom of God, and there's the wisdom of Satan. Three definite wisdoms the Bible speaks of. We have to follow the wisdom of God, and it says the wisdom of this world wars with the wisdom of God. Isn't that powerful? Because if you are underneath culture developed by worldly wisdom, 2 and 2 makes 4, 4 and 4 makes 8, how in the world are you going to release yourself to feed 5,000 people with 2 fish and a few loaves of bread? Your mind won't allow you to go there. Your worldly culture says it's wrong. And so you cannot reach into the depths of faith and draw it out, because it just does not compute. So many people who are underneath a culture of this world system are good people. They don't want to war against God. It's just the way they see God. If I put a pair of sunglasses on, I still see humanity, but I see them tainted through the glasses I'm looking through. And when we look at things through the knowledge or the wisdom that is in us and that is governing us, then we have to understand. Now, we know that we are in the world, but we're not of the world. I know that I deal with the world on a daily basis, and I don't deal with the world on a godly wisdom, but I deal with God on a godly wisdom when I walk with him. In my administration, in my office, I tell them not to get so spiritually minded that they're no earthly good. We're dealing with the world every day. But we have a hidden wisdom. We have a hidden stream that we can go to, and that God can work in our lives through it, and the world doesn't understand it. I try and sit down and completely explain to somebody how I got this money to buy this thing, and they look at me and say, you are a hamburger short of a happy meal. Why would I try to explain heavenly wisdom to a worldly person? I discredit myself and make myself look like a fool. Because the Bible says that that person is going to look at me and think that I'm a foolish, because he's governed by the wisdom of this world. And that doesn't make him a bad person. It just makes me an idiot for trying to make him see something that he has no understanding of. And that's what it talks about. Don't throw your pearls before swine. They'll trample them underfoot. And there's nothing worse when God touches you and you run to somebody and you try and get them all excited about God touching you and you seeing something, and all of a sudden they start to argue with you and they say, come on, get a life. And they're very sincere and they start to argue back with you, and that's when you have to hide those things in your heart. And let them come to pass until they then come. And you can actually say to them, look, I could tell you what's going on in my life and you wouldn't understand. The only way that I can get you to understand is to first introduce you to the beginnings or the origin of that life, which is Christ. And at that point, you will start to see the difference. But you know, you might as well be speaking Japanese and I'm speaking English. We're both trying to tell each something, but neither one of us have a clue what we're saying. We can see that there's an intensity of communication, but no understanding. And it's only Christ that become the interpreter. It's like, if you ever met a person, you think they're saying the same things you're saying because they're talking to you, and you say, oh, finally someone understands. But then they start acting totally different. Because one is saying it from the head and one is saying it from the heart. One has heart understanding or spirit understanding, and one just is like a parrot. A parrot can say, hey Wayne, how you doing? Great, how are you? Hey Wayne, how you doing? Hasn't got a clue what it's saying. I had a friend and he was a prophet. I was driving through the city where he lived and I thought, I'm just going to bless him. So I had a few $100 in my pocket and I was just going to drop off. So I went around to his house and I could hear him, but I couldn't see him. So I thought, he must be in his basement. I'll sneak down into the basement and just leave the money on the table, because he prays down there. So I get down into the basement. I could hear him praying and I'm looking, and he's not there anywhere. And I see this big white cockatoo down in his basement. And this cockatoo is... I thought, this guy's so holy, even his cockatoo's baptized in the Holy Ghost. And it prayed just like him. And then you'd hear, oh glory, hallelujah, praise the Lord. And it would go backwards and forwards on the perch. Hallelujah. I was amazed. And I'm standing there looking at the cockatoo, and the Lord said to me, that's a lot like my church. It's in our heads, but it's not in our hearts. It hasn't dropped down. And so one of the worst things that can happen is when we get caught up spiritually, we lose perception of depth for time. Because there is no time. Things that I saw 20 years ago are only starting to come to pass now. Yet when I saw them, I felt they were going to happen the next day. Because they were so real in the spirit. And you have to be careful and you have to learn how to bring those things about and understand those things and put them into their right place. Or you can wreck people's lives. You can coax them into going out. Oh, I saw in the spirit you have a ministry. Maybe they did 10 years down the road. But if you teach them to step out before their time, that can cause a slapping. Because you see, things start to come unstuck. So I want to talk a little bit about the three kings that are the dominant kings of the Bible. And there are three moves of the ark. There was two tabernacles and a temple. Represent the three kings. We have King Saul, which was the king of the flesh. Asked for by the flesh, dominated by the flesh, and lived for the flesh. It's amazing that when we see that the word Saul means one asked for. The second Saul, the apostle Paul, came from the same tribe of Benjamin. And Saul means one asked for, and Paul means one given. It's a representative of our lives that all of us are a Saul with a Paul growing up on the inside of us. The Paul of the Spirit has to eventually dominate the Saul of the flesh if we are to move into the dimensions of God. We see that David came after Saul, which was a man of the Spirit, a man after God's own heart. Then we see Solomon coming after David. And Solomon was a king that built a house where the glory was kept. Glory, he tainted it by the wisdom of man. He made alliances with all these other cultures by marrying into them, which the church has done today, and has developed a powerless gospel in its New Age application. It's written the book of Ecclesiastes, which is the book of wisdom, yet a mixture of worldly wisdom and godly wisdom that paralyzes each other. Neither one of them work to any extreme. It's like a husband and a wife opposed polarizes a relationship that it can't go anywhere. The opposition stopped them from doing anything, and so they just hover. Where even if they would come to a 50% agreement, they would be moving at least forwards. And the more agreement they can come into, the more that they start to develop and accumulate and become victorious. It's getting two people to walk as one, to see the same things, to realize that they complete each other rather than compete with each other, to get them onto the same page, to realize that they're not to dominate each other, but to walk with each other, and that both have strengths that are very beneficial. It's very hard because of that worldly wisdom that is within the temple. One of the things that will paralyze the gospel of Jesus Christ from working in people's lives to bring them to that place, because the only thing that we have that transports us to a place of victory is the purity of the word. God watches over his word to perform it. The more purity we have in the word, the more we bring people to identify to the new covenant, the more he is unleashed to work. Because God doesn't watch over personalities, he watches over his word. Remember when he gave Joshua the key to success, he said, "Let this book not depart out of thy mouth, but meditate therein day and night, that thou may observe to do all that is written therein. Then shalt thou make thy way successful and have good success," in Joshua 1:8. So he's saying, Joshua, your success is going to depend on how much of my covenant or my word you get in your heart. Remember in Deuteronomy, anyone who observes this word and obeys it, they'll be blessed in the city, they'll be blessed in the country, they'll be blessed when they come in, they'll be blessed. Anyone who hears this word and doesn't put it into practice, these curses will come on them. So it's the word in us that works. The more pure the doctrine, the more it works. But when we have people that are caught between two wisdoms, or even three wisdoms, cultivating the word to be acceptable to our culture, then we just have a philosophy of life. And we don't have supernatural empowerment working with it. And so we see when Joshua came to Jericho in Joshua chapter 5, we see something happen that's really us in a nutshell. Verse 13. Joshua now had crossed over. He had 10 cities to overcome. 10 major strong points. Isn't it amazing that we have 10 commandments, and those 10 commandments are not laws, but are doors. They are doors for Satan to come through into our life. Isn't that powerful? The reason that we were given those 10 commandments was that by our actions, we closed the doors to Satan. The moment we break one of those 10 commandments, we open a door to Satan. Isn't that powerful? So then we knew that we couldn't live them by law, but we can live them by grace. Because we can repent over them when we realize we're breaking them. They couldn't repent over them, but we can. Because we now have a way of closing the door by grace and by mercy. And so here he comes to the first city, and it was called Jericho. He looks at it and he's so intimidated because they're having chariot races around the top of it. They've got an army that far outnumbers his army. They have equipment that far outnumber his equipment. And he says, "God, we're gone." He starts asking a question, "Who are you for? Are you for them or are you for us?" What did he mean? Are they going to kill us today or are we going to kill them? Who's going to win? Have you ever come to a point, are you for my husband or are you for me? Are you for my wife? Are you for me? Are you for this person? Who are you for today, God? You ever had that situation, God, how do you choose which one you're going to be for? Chooses his word. Because what he says when he comes to Joshua, and Joshua was at this place, listen to verse 13. He says, "And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, Art thou for us or for our adversaries? And he said, Nay, but as captain of the host of the Lord am I now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship and said unto him, What says my Lord unto his servant? And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place wherein thou standest is holy. And Joshua did so. So when we are coming into a battle, we have to be standing on holy ground. Holy ground is the covenant. The sword that he held in his hand was his covenant, his word. The captain of the Lord's host was Jesus, because right up until the cross, he was never known as Jesus. You see, you can see a person thoroughly mixed up when they're using all the names of God and not using the name of Jesus. Because every name of God was incorporated in the name of Jesus. He gave him a name that was above every name in heaven, on earth, and below the earth. So the name the Lord Jesus Christ incorporates every other name that God was ever known by and brings it all to a conclusion or to a fortified head. So instead of using all these different names and throwing them at the enemy, you have one concentrated name that just hits the enemy. Isn't that powerful? When you look at that, when you can take all this power that's out here known by all these other names and bring it all into one name, one central point, like a laser beam. Bang. And so when we know that, we can see that. And that's what the covenant does. The covenant gives authority to that name. And that's why we need to know it. I'm taking you somewhere. The Lord said, I'm not for either one of you. No, I'm here to watch over the word of the Lord as captain of the Lord's host in my camp. Nay, I'm not for either one of you. You do what you were told, Joshua, and you will arise victorious today because God will be watching over his word in you. You move from that word and you're going to be a statistic. Isn't that powerful? You see, that's the whole key. Are you with me? And isn't that beautiful? That means the more word any one of us can get, the more we align ourselves with success. Isn't that what he was saying to Joshua when he was given Joshua the actual victory lesson? Now, what Satan does to do is dilute the authority of the word. That's what he did to Israel with the temple. Much of the culture that Israel has today, it came from Solomon's time, mixed in with every other culture that was brought in. Yet you have today Christians trying to bring that culture back into the church, rather than to develop the culture of the New Testament church, which becomes the culture of the New Israel. When you meet Christians, they have a culture. Culture is our belief. It's who we are. Our culture is our morality. It's our integrity. It's the way we present ourselves to the world. But we are doing what has happened in Solomon's time. We are bringing in all these other cultures trying to make peace. So we don't want to offend anybody. And we have diluted the protection and the power of God. And our gospel doesn't work for those people that really need it. And there's nothing worse than seeing people coming into your church that need supernatural deliverance because you can't deliver them. You can identify with their problems, but unless God gets involved, unless God gets into this, man, it's going to kill you. So our gospel has to have a supernatural empowerment where people are talking to a real God that works in miraculous ways and works in their lives, and they're coming in and saying, you should see what happened today. Now there's a great tragedy that's happening with the church because Satan has to blind you to Calvary. And I want to tell you that 99% of the church today are no different than the Jews. They're still waiting for their Messiah. If you believe that your Messiah has come, then you believe that he has accomplished all that he said that he had accomplished. That healing is yours, prosperity is yours, reconciliation is yours. You wouldn't be asking him to heal somebody. You would believe that he's already done it and that you need to get that person transported into his covenant where they can enjoy that healing. You wouldn't be asking him to prosper somebody because you would realize he's already become poverty, that they might become well cared for. He's already become sickness. You wouldn't be asking him to save somebody because you'd realize that no one else on the face of the earth can be saved. It was completed 2,000 years ago. What we have to do is to get them to see their salvation so they can collect it. To get them to see their healing so they can collect it. To get them to see their prosperity so that they can live in it. It finished, was his words. What was finished? Redemption was finished. When he's coming back, he's not coming back to heal us. He's not coming back to deliver us. He's coming back to make war on the nations of the earth. I'm not in a hurry to see his second coming. I'm still trying to deal with his first. My mind, I don't think, is ready for his second coming. The world is still reeling 2,000 years after his first coming. And so what we have is Satan blinding our mind and transporting us back to the other side of the cross, where we're taking a little bit of the old, a little bit of the new, mixing it together and making our own covenant. Now, this happened not long after Calvary. This caused great dissension, that you had the Pharisees coming and trying to implement into the church the culture of old Israel, because it was a young church and didn't have any of its own culture. It was just beginning. So if you open your Bibles at Acts chapter 15, we're going to have a look, and we're going to see that God is going to take us back out of the tabernacle of Solomon and bring us back to the tabernacle of David. Now, the tabernacle of David ran for 40 years. It was an obstruction. It was against the law. In other words, it should never have came into being. It only ran for 40 years, one generation. And it's going to run in its purity for the last generation, when all the religious rigmarole will be torn down. In the tabernacle of David, there was no brazen altar. There was no table of showbread. There was no brazen laver. There was none of these things. All it was God's glory in the midst of the people. And that released the people into such freedom and such intensity of worship that it was no striving, I have to do this, I have to do that, I have to have this, and I have to have that. They just came in with such a freedom to worship God. Isn't that powerful? And that's what we're going to have a look at here. So what happened was, when the Jewish rabbis, the Pharisees and Sadducees, and others saw the freedom of the church, they said, we can't have this. We have to bring some type of law and order into this. Now, I can understand that to a degree. We have to have character. There's no excuse for lack of character. The New Testament priesthood and the Old Testament priesthood are so different. The Old Testament priesthood were policemen. Whenever you have a law, you have to have a police force to enforce the law. But the New Testament priesthood is not. They don't expose sin, they cover it. So you can get torn in a hard place. Do I cover this person? Do I expose this person? Should I go to the pastor? Because you've got the two laws talking to you. And it can mess your head up pretty bad, can't it? So let's read here in chapter 15 of the book of Acts. And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. When therefore Paul and Barnabas had no more dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain others of them go to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question. And being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phrygia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles. And they caused great joy unto all the brethren. And when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church and of the apostles and elders, and they declared all things that God had done with them. But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. So here we have a dissension in the leadership. Here you have a new covenant and an old covenant clashing. So you had people that said, you've got to keep the law of Moses and you've got to keep the culture of old Israel. And the apostles and the elders came together to consider of this matter. And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now listen to verse 10. Now therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? Why are you bringing this Old Testament back that we weren't able to bear, nor was our fathers able to bear? So this was going on, and then in verse 11, but we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved even as they. Then all the multitude kept silence and gave audience to Barnabas and Paul, declaring what miracles and wonders God had wrought among the Gentiles by them. And after they had their peace, James answered, saying, men and brethren, hearken unto me.
Simon,
have declared how God at first did visit the Gentiles to take out of them a people for his
name, and to this
agree the words of the prophets as it is written. After this I'll return and build again the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down, and I will build again the ruins thereof, and I will set it up. So here he's saying that we're going to get beyond the law of the prophets. We're going to get beyond the law of Moses, and we're going to come into the circumcision of the heart. We're going to come into a new covenant, a new time, and a new dimension. So here they were starting to catch up. Now, this continued with no small matter. Even though that the apostles declared that this shouldn't be done, others went out to intermix old Israel and new Israel. And they were determined they were going to do so. God catches Paul up into heaven. And 2 Corinthians chapter 12 says this, "A new man in Christ, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, who ascended unto the third heaven, where he said, I received revelation that wasn't lawful to be uttered amongst men, amongst Jews, which was grace and mercy." So what was the book that he received? It was the epistle of Galatians. And so if we want to see what Paul saw when he went to heaven, all we have to do is go to the book of Galatians, the book of freedom. Now, I want you to just turn to chapter 3 of the book of Galatians, read verse 24 with me, and 25. And we'll get a little bit of understanding what the law was meant to do and what grace was meant to do. "Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us into Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after faith is come, we are no longer under the schoolmaster." The law was to bring us to a place of guilt. You see, this is how wrong the law was. If someone was rebellious, they would get stoned. If a woman was caught in adultery or a man, they'd get stoned. If your children were rebellious, you'd get stoned. If you carry a burden on the Sabbath, you'd get stoned. And you think God was a brutal God. But not when you read the law, because the law found everyone guilty. Therefore, the law polarized itself and no one by rights could stone anyone. It was just meant to show us our sinful condition. But others thought that they had arrived at a dimension in the law that they were able to implement it. But in all honesty, the law should never have been implemented, because there was none found without sin. So the law was to disappear. So let's have a look at that even clearer. And go with me to verse 19 of chapter 4. And we're going to read something. "My little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you." What's he travailing? That the purity of the new covenant be formed in them, because what had come is people had come and sown seeds of the law. And under the anointing, they both grew up together and brought a powerless gospel. They brought what we call a mule. A mule is a donkey and a horse, but a mule can't produce another mule. It loses its power to reproduce. And Satan takes the reproductive organs out of the church by causing it to become a mule, taking the old and the new and mixing it together. We will lose that reproductive authority and power. So let's have a look here. "My little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you." The purity of freedom he's talking about. "So I desire to be present with you now and to change my voice, for I stand in doubt of you. Tell me, ye that desire to be under the law, do ye not hear the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondwoman and the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was born by promise. Verse 24, which things are an allegory? For these are the two covenants, the one from the Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar, and from Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all." Now, what is an analogy? It's a type of. Isn't it amazing when God was talking to Abraham, he said, "Bring thy only son." He wouldn't acknowledge the son of the flesh, which was the law. So let's read on here and see what he says. Verse 27, "For it is written, rejoice thou barren that bearest not, break forth and cry, thou that travailest not. For the desolate have many more children than she which had a husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, so it is now. Nevertheless, what says the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. So how can you have the two covenants cohabiting? It's going to cause strife. So he said you have to cast one out. And what we do is we try and make them live in the same house. And it's impossible. It will cause strife. We will become mules, and our gospel will not be productive. And therefore, people are crying out to a God, but because of the belief of their heart, they polarize him. He cannot serve two covenants. And Satan cleverly tries to bring them together. The first covenant, which is, you know, half man and half God, brought about by man, like the first king, will bring death and destruction and bondage. The second king brought life. And the third king brought confusion. So listen now to chapter 5. Remember, there were no chapters. So listen. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherein Christ has made us free. And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. What is the yoke of bondage? The yoke of the law, the old covenant, and the law of Moses. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. Listen to that verse. If you embrace the law, you polarize the effects of Christianity. The power of the gospel can't work in your life. And hence, we have a powerless church. Read it again. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherein Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Listen to verse 4. Christ is become of no effect unto you whatsoever. Of you who are justified by the law, ye have fallen from grace. Oh my God. Can you see the cleverness? Can you see how he brings it in to bring us out of that power? He did it very cleverly and brought us into a time which was called the medieval times and brought us into the dark ages and paralyzed the effect of God. And that's why we call it the dark age. Until Martin Luther again started to bring separation. And people don't understand the very schemes of Satan. And all they have to do is to observe history. A church birthed in such power, such majesty, such strength to heal a broken humanity, to give hope where there was no hope, faith where there was no faith, reconciliation where there was no reconciliation, became the greatest oppressor of the world. That in the name of Jesus Christ, over 80 million people were slaughtered because of a wrong interpretation that made the holy war and what is going on in the world today. What is going on in Iraq right now is fueled by Christianity, purging it. It is no different than the holy wars of yesterday and will bring to the war of all wars that we are borderlining on a war that will be the final war between Muslims and Christians. They're playing right into Satan's hands. And if you can see it through time and understand it, stupidity. It's not Christianity. It's not what Jesus Christ represented. There was one man who understood Christianity probably better than the Christian church. He renounced his own religion and refused to identify to Christianity because of what it was, and that was a man called Gandhi. He renounced his own religion. He renounced every religion as he knew it. And the only reason he got into the teachings of Christ was because he was dragged off a train and beaten because he was black and refused to move seats in South Africa. And he went to the Bible to find out what type of God could people be serving and discovered Jesus Christ and said, why can't people live what this man taught? This man was the greatest mentor of humanity. And he adapted passive resistance in the life of Christ and changed the nation. If you study what he got into, but he wouldn't identify with the Christian church because he said it didn't believe in the very things that Jesus came to teach. He said passive resistance is the most violent resistance in the world. Amazing, isn't it? Yet we have polarized the gospel by making our own gospel and what we believe and what we don't believe. Turn me to the book of Hebrews. I'm going to give you a little bit of something that if you'll bear with me, I'm not trying to make a fool of you. I'm trying to provoke you to such a hunger and desire that you will want to discover what the new covenant is. The new covenant was formed on 8,886 promises. It is a covenant founded on promise of mercy and grace. It is a completion. It wasn't founded on law. If you can discover it, you can live a life that you can make a difference. It has a power that is beyond any power that we can ever imagine. It is the completed works of Christ. Here, chapter 8, verse 6. But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. For if the first covenant had been faultless, no place had been sought for a second. Verse 13, in that he hath set a new covenant, he hath made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. So if it had just been a supplement of the old covenant or a completion, we should call this year 6005, shouldn't we? But there came a separation. One dropped off and a new started. So this is a new covenant, not an old covenant. Where does the new covenant start? The book of Acts. It doesn't start Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. That is the completion. That is the formation of the covenant. That is Jesus saying, foxes have holes, birds have nests, man has no place to lay down his head. In other words, I've come and give up my home to purchase a home back for you. So it's the formation of a covenant. He was completing the law and fulfilling everything. He couldn't change one little iota of it. He had to live as the perfect man. And then he had to die as the perfect lamb. And he had to. That's why the passion didn't do the cross justice. If you could picture on that cross, not the broken of what man done to him, or what God done to him. If you could picture all insanity filtering into his brain, every disease filtering into his body, our human minds could not comprehend that cross. Could never, ever comprehend what happened there. He had to be tempted on every level. No wonder he sweated drops of blood in anticipation. Many people had gone to the cross. Wasn't the cross is what he took there and became the filtration where he actually took every bit of sin and took it down to the depths of hell where it belonged and walked through the fires of hell and left it in hell and came out the other side where he was purified by the... And you know that 99.9% of Christians won't admit Jesus went to hell. But hell couldn't hold him. But he had to take all that stuff somewhere. That's why Mary couldn't touch him when he was resurrected, because he hadn't yet gone into Revelation chapter 5, where he went into heaven and redeemed us, where he took his blood into the mercy room. I tell you, if you could come to some type of understanding of what he went through, my mind doesn't want to know. Because I couldn't even begin to think of what happened to him there that day and what he did for me. And he never wants me to even think about that, because he wants me to live in the life that he purchased for me, not be controlled by the guilt of the price that he paid. We even do that when we buy each other presents. It's an insult to ask someone, what'd you pay for this? Isn't it? When he gave us life, he removed the price tag that we couldn't see it. And he just loved us so much that he gave it to us. Turn with me quickly to Ephesians. I want to tell you something. If you weren't a Jew and you weren't born a Jew, then the old covenant had nothing whatsoever to do with you. Do you know that? It was only for the nation of Israel. Here in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11. Wherefore remember that ye being in times past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called the uncircumcision by them which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands. Listen to verse 12. That at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes were afar off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace that have made both one and have broken down the middle wall of partition between us. Listen to verse 15. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of the commandments contained in the ordinances, to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace. So he abolished the law in his flesh. How dare we try and resurrect it and the culture of it? When you're identifying to that culture, you're identifying to an old life. You cannot hold dual citizenship in the kingdom of heaven. When I became a citizen of heaven, I gave up my citizenship of Australia and I became a Christian. Now, if I kept that, I'm under two spirits, because every culture has what's called a king spirit. Every culture. Now, listen to me where I'm taking you.
Satan has no right to influence you unless you identify with your old culture. Because the church is a new, a holy nation, and its spirit is the
Holy Ghost
to work out the nature of the culture of heaven in us according to the new covenant. King's spirits over other nations, they will follow. People will leave one nation and come to America. They will recreate their culture in this nation. And we do that in Christianity. So we're no different than Solomon's time.
Have you ever had a revelation? Here, the book of Revelation. People call it the book of Revelations. You know the real name of this book is? The Revelation of Jesus Christ. Why would John need a revelation of Jesus Christ? He didn't see Jesus the other side of the cross. He saw Jesus the man. Do you know that most people today still see Jesus the man? They've never had a revelation of Jesus the Christ the other side of the cross, because they still live in the Gospels. They never live in the book of Acts, the other side of the cross. So they're still blinded, and they see Jesus, the man, rather than Jesus, the God of all creation. And so John, who had put his head in the very bosom of Jesus, the man, now gets a revelation of Jesus, the Christ, and falls down like a dead man. He sees Jesus, the other side of the cross, the King of all creation, the Lord of lords. He said the brilliance of the man was like the sun in itself. He said his voice was like the sound of many waterfalls. He said the authority that came out of him was like a sharp two-edged sword. I didn't know this man. Because he saw Jesus the God, Jesus the Emperor, Jesus the Lord of Lords, Jesus the King of Kings. You see, none of them knew. So when you look at the book of Revelation, it dealt with past tense, present tense, future tense. So the only way that someone could identify what really happened was to go back, present, and forward. So what happens is John was caught up into heaven before Jesus Christ, before the name Jesus Christ ever existed. Because I want to take you there, because he had to understand the cross and what it was about. Now come with me and read Revelation chapter 5 as you start to discover Jesus in a new dimension. When he took me through this walk, I nearly came out of my body. When he explained it to me to teach me to become a preacher of the new covenant. And I had a doctor of theology. What do you mean a preacher of the new covenant? I was still making my own covenant. I had no idea what the new covenant was. I was as confused as everybody else. More. I've been messed up by a cemetery. I mean, a seminary. Chapter 5. You've got to look. I want you to read it with me. Come on, get this revelation. I'm going to take you somewhere this morning that's going to blow you apart. If you just, all of this was to bring you to here. And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside sealed with 7 seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof?" And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look therein. And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look therein. Stop there. This is the book of life. This is before Jesus. This is before the soul of God came out of God and into Mary's womb. No man in heaven, on earth, or below the earth was found worthy. So Jesus, at this point, he hasn't seen him. He can't find him in heaven. He ran up to Elijah. "Elijah, would you open the book? Come on." I can't, John. I'm not worthy."
"Samson, would you come in and open the book?"
"I'm sorry, John. I can't. I'm not worthy."
"Moses, would you come in and open?"
"I'm sorry, John. I'm not worthy." "Esther, you, would you come?" "I can't, John. I'm not worthy." And he sits down. And he's weeping because the book can't be opened. No one that he went to could come and open the book of life. And he sits down and he's weeping much. Then listen to this, verse 4. "And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open the book and neither to look thereon. And one of the elders said unto me, Weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the 7 seals thereof. And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne, and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the world. And he came, and he took the book out of the right hand of him that sat upon the throne. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayer of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book, and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain, and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood, out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, that we shall reign on the earth. And I beheld and I heard the voice of many angels around about the throne, and the beast and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000, and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which was in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and with such as in the sea and all that are in them heard I saying, Blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever. Oh my God. He gets the revelation. He looks up out of his desperation and he sees Jesus walking through those golden streets, bringing his blood down into the mercy room of heaven, down into the Holy of Holies, and pouring it out and taking the book of life and opening it up. And all of a sudden, there's a whole new creation born where they said, He's brought us out of every kindred and tongue, people and nation, and made us unto our God one new people. And he gets the revelation of Calvary. He gets the revelation of Jesus. Why he came. What he purchased. And oh my God. He now is the King of Kings. He now is the Lord of Lords. There is none like him in all the earth. And he does not leave out Israel. He made us. He brought us out of every kindred and tongue. And I think we do Israel an injustice by not preaching the exact same gospel to them. Let us preach to the rest of the world.